Cohen is the David and Mary Winton Green Professor of Political Science at the University of Chicago. She's also the Deputy Provost for Graduate Education and the former Director of the Center for the Study of Race, Politics, and Culture at the University of Chicago. She is the author of the book, The Boundaries of Blackness, AIDS and the Breakdown of Black Politics, which was published in 1999. A lot of times when I teach this book, my students say, we're going to talk about AIDS from 1999. And I was like, no, we're going to talk about belonging, and we're going to talk about how we create community and how we marginalize others in spaces that people otherwise think are safe. And they go, and that was written when? And we're still talking about that now? Absolutely. So that is what Professor Cohen does in the first book, is she challenges us to rethink commitments to community and understandings of belonging. She warned us of how marginalized communities act on their own versions of societal hierarchies that further the suffering of those within their groups in ways that personalize the pain, because it's the members of the group who thought they were in who actually find out that they're out. That Cathy helps us to really think critically about how who we belong and who we choose to exclude is more of a reflection on us than it is on them. She continues that same type of questioning and challenging in her second book, Democracy Remix, Black Youth and the Future of American Politics, which is a major data beast of a book. Featuring a project that she's worked on for quite a while called the Black Youth Project, that's also housed out of the University of Chicago. But in the book, Cathy does an incredible job of capturing the hopes, the aspirations, joys, and challenges of America's Black youth, examining their thoughts and ideas on various topics from sex and sexuality to hip-hop to the Obama marriage, in only a way that Cathy can string those things together and make them all resound with all of us. But in that book, she reminds us again that we're often discounting youth and ignoring them in such a way that, but they actually hold the ticket or hold the real framework of how future policies should guide our lives. So there's a theme here about an attentiveness to the discounted, the left out, the left behind, the neglected, the least of these, which is a hallmark not only of her scholarship, but if you have an opportunity to ever look at the Black Youth Project's website, you'll see that it comes through in her research, but it also comes through in her service, where she is an active participant in a number of projects from charter schools in the city of Chicago to projects like Ella's Daughter, African American Women in Defense of Ourselves, and countless other organizations that speak to this notion of it's to the least of these that we owe the most. So please join me in welcoming my colleague, Cathy Cohen. How's everybody doing?
Good.
I'm not advertising Coca-Cola. That's how it is.
One second.
I want to make sure everyone can hear. We good?
Mm-hmm.
Very good. Wow, what do you say after an introduction like that? I said to Wendy, my heart is full. It's so impressive when people who introduce you can explain your work better than you can. And I would expect nothing less from the brilliant Wendy Smooth. So thank you so much for the invitation, for the introduction, for also the incredible work and thinking that you do. I want to thank the Department of Women, Gender, and Sexuality Studies for the invitation to the Ohio State University. Did I get it right?
Yeah.
This is a crowd that doesn't buy into that right now. So I won't mention the national with the championship and all that stuff. I happen to have gotten my graduate degree at Michigan, so I'm not really happy to be here. But I also want to thank all the co-sponsors for this event and say what a treat it is to be back. I don't know how many people know, but I'm actually from Ohio, Toledo, Ohio. I did my undergraduate work at Miami University in Oxford, Ohio. And I lived in Columbus for a while when I was working for Senator John Glenn. So this really does feel like being back on old stomping grounds. Let me just start in. I want to say up front, and someone should be timing me. If I go too long, you'll let me know. that the talk is motivated, sadly, by the killing of Michael Brown, John Crawford, Eric Garner, Tamir Rice, Renisha McBride, you know, I don't have his name, the brother on Skid Row that was killed. People see that video recently?
Yeah.
Right? We could unfortunately go on and on and on. But this is also a talk influenced by my attempt to think through what I think political solidarity based on, I dare say, radical empathy and love might look like. My concern is whether how and whose black lives actually do matter. Does the struggle or the movement or the moment, however you deem it, that we're in right now, right? That we see unfolding daily on our streets and highways, in city halls and shopping centers across the country, does that even matter? And I'm especially interested in the conditions of what we might call political solidarity, or what I might say is kind of support without sacrifice versus what I'm thinking of as kind of radical empathy, radical support, radical love. Specifically, how do we differentiate between a kind of performative solidarity versus a substantive solidarity? And I'm concerned that too many organizations, public officials, and those of us kind of just living our lives are engaged in a kind of contradictory project of performing solidarity with this new black youth-led movement, while substantively being complicit with the dominant neoliberal structure whose racial politics will always threaten the lives of people of color, in particular poor black people. Okay? So finally, this afternoon, I want us to think about how the kind of current structure of this movement or moment might begin to actualize a new radical queer politics led by people of color, rooted in love and empathy, the thing I talked about in Punk's Bulldagger and Bulldaggers and Welfare. So this onslaught of public death at the hands of police officers and vigilantes, as well as the all too less talked about attack on black women, black trans men and women, right, has ignited what I believe is a new movement for liberation and freedom that I want to be clear, and others will talk about this in a minute, is not some updated version of the civil rights movement, as some would claim or even hope for. Instead, I think this is an inclusive politics that is actually reimagining what justice, democracy, and even love looks like. So this afternoon, I want to offer some of my thoughts on kind of this maddening, complicated, and energizing moment in the history that got us to this point. So I'll deliver the lecture, and the lecture will be in three parts, each intended to build on the last, although that might not work, and if it doesn't, we'll talk about it during question and answer, okay? The first section is titled Neoliberalism and the Unmaking of Michael Brown. And in that section, I briefly try to explore how neoliberal policies serve as really the backdrop for violence and resistance in black communities, especially at this moment. The second section, titled Performing Solidarity, tries to interrogate the current kind of racialized politics of LGBT organizations and their reoccurring compromise with and corruption by neoliberalism. Now, this is a kind of well-traveled theme, but one that I believe actually deserves kind of rediscovery right now. And I should say up front that this focus on LGBT organizations is not meant to say that these are the only organizations involved in such a compromise, right? But instead, I'm focused on them because I actually hope for a different level of commitment from this community. I might call it my community, right? The third and final section is titled, This is Not the Civil Rights Movement, The Queering of Black Liberation. And in this section, I try to briefly revisit work that I think a couple of classes read today on the article, Punks, Bulldaggers, and Welfare Queens, suggesting that radical black liberation is taking the form of what many of us imagine a radical queer politics might look like. I've talked about it before, it's kind of a queer nationalism. These radical formations are able to address the kind of complicated nature of politics and black politics under both neoliberalism and the reign of President Obama. Moreover, these new formations, again, might actualize a kind of radical black love in the political domain. So I'm going to get started. Everybody set?
No.
Cool. Now, let me kind of warn you. I start talks like these on Ferguson and others by showing some videos. I've come to learn these can be very upsetting videos, right? So I'm going to give everybody fair warning. If you want to put your head down, that's fine, or whatever. But it is really to, in many ways, center us, right? Usually in yoga, you center yourself around something really kind of pleasant. We're going to center ourselves and think about kind of where we're going intellectually by making clear what's at stake here. So Diamond Humphrey, will you start the video? Can you get the sound? According to Darren Wilson, the officer who killed Michael Brown on the streets in Ferguson, Missouri, Michael Brown had superhuman strength. Wilson referred to the unarmed black teenager as similar to Hulk Hogan in strength. He told ABC reporter George Stephanopoulos that he, Wilson, quote, was like a five-year-old holding on to Hulk Hogan, end quote, with Michael Brown being Hulk Hogan. He went on to say that when Brown turned back around toward him, to look toward him, Brown looked like a demon. As I watched the interview with Wilson, I wondered how does one come to view a young man with no gun, who had just graduated from high school and who was not actually that much bigger than Wilson, with such venom, disregard, and fear. Similarly, how do police in Cleveland, in the wake of the Trayvon Martin, Jordan Davis, Michael Brown, John Crawford, Ayanna Jones, and Eric Garner killings, just to mention a few, how do they take less than 2 seconds to kill 12-year-old Tamir Rice as he holds a toy gun? Journalists, politicians, and even some activists have pitched these stories as struggles between young black men, who we are told are not angels, and police officers and vigilantes who we are told fear for their lives. And while a narrative of these encounters that focuses on the personalities of both victim and killer serves the media, what has too often been minimized is the larger political context, which helped to produce the aggressive policing that has proven to be fatal in many black communities. So for just a moment, I want to pull the story back and talk about the larger context and the role of neoliberalism in the unmaking of Michael Brown. Now, by neoliberalism, I mean a kind of prioritizing of markets with a corresponding commitment to the dismantling or devolution of social welfare from the national government to states, local units, and private entities. Without going through the kind of history of neoliberalism, which scholars from David Harvey to Lisa Dugan have detailed in really critical books, It's important to remember that the project of neoliberalism was made visible first during the Nixon administration, but took root under President Reagan. At the heart of Reagan's neoliberal policies and approach was greater market expansion and freedom, but with a corresponding dissolution of what was formerly known as the safety net. It's important to remember that neoliberalism's emergence marks the end of the expansionist state that existed during the civil rights movement. Unlike the context facing movements in the 1960s, where there still existed low-skilled living wage jobs and the belief in the state as a provider of a safety net, activists today face an environment of constricting job opportunities for poor and unskilled workers and a direct attack on the idea of a safety net and those who might use it. Thus, proponents of neoliberalism have pursued not only a policy agenda of restriction and privatization, but also a set of ideological commitments and rhetorical strategies meant to create and demonize those associated with state support. They have equated those receiving aid from the state as some other, often a racialized other. For example, Reagan's war against poor communities included a policy agenda of defunding social services, as well as a rhetorical strategy mobilizing tropes like the welfare queen, meant to demean and distance those on welfare. Thus, in order to rationalize the restriction of the social welfare state, right, that benefited in real numbers more white people than people of color, there had to be a process of misrepresenting those who were kind of associated with the social safety net. Toward this end, there was a deployment of images and ideas and concepts and tropes such as super predators that helped to create and solidify, again, that other that whites and middle class people of color could rally against. These others were portrayed as different from our normal. They were abusing and dependent on state support, specifically taxpayer money, suggesting, of course, that they themselves were not taxpayers. They were characterized as violent, manipulative, and engaged in illegal activity. They were described as being hypersexual and as having multiple children out of wedlock, and of course, uninterested in raising those children. This other was fundamentally in need of state-sponsored surveillance and policing, if the rest of us, right, were to survive their invasion. The invasion of these monsters with strength like Hulk Hogan and who looked like demons. It was this process of othering under neoliberalism that fueled would only and will not label white resentment politics. Everybody with me? I can't see you with my glasses. You're like a blur, so I'm trying to get a sense of how you're doing. All right. Now, political scientist Tali Mendelberg has also discussed white resentment politics, arguing that whites are resentful over black claims to resources, resources they believe that blacks do not deserve. She and other social scientists and political scientists like Donald Kinder and Lynn Sanders suggest that whites cloak their racism or negative racial predispositions in a symbolic racism, where blacks are represented not as inherently inferior, but instead as culturally inferior. Right? White respondents on surveys claim that blacks do not adhere to liberal values of individualism and do not work hard, and thus white resentment is rooted not in the biological racism of Jim Crow, right, of the past. Instead, their negative feelings toward poor blacks in particular are about a violation of supposedly shared norms that creates this white resentment toward norm violators, who most often, it is argued, just happen to be poor black people. Thus, believing the safety net to be the domain of special rights and benefits for some racialized other who are violating norms and benefiting from such behavior, whites were willing actually to assist in its deconstruction. Now, white resentment politics has also been coupled with white fear. Sociologist Eduardo Mejia Silva reminds us that the most segregated lived experience of any group in this country is actually that of white Americans. Whites are more likely to live among, go to school with, work with, attend church with, socialize with, and marry other white people. Thus, the idea of white fear toward an unknown other is actually real, facilitated by their segregated lived experience, the mobilization of fearful kind of images often in the media of people of color, and the actual creation of devastated and dangerous urban areas. Now, under neoliberalism, we have witnessed the disinvestment in poor and urban areas, where living wage, low-skill jobs have become nearly extinct, where the housing stock has become battered and debilitated, where neighborhood schools have been neglected in lieu of charter and magnet schools, and where the middle class have exited, trying to guarantee, supposedly, their own survival. In their out-migration, sociologist William Julius Wilson contends that whites and then the black middle class have left behind those he labels the truly disadvantaged. Individuals inhabiting poor, blighted areas with few recognized resources and even fewer job opportunities. Ironically, even when blacks and then whites return to these same neighborhoods, it is often through a process of gentrification, displacing old residents and allowing for greater private development of land, often close to city centers. Now, with such devastation and despair, the neoliberal response has been to bracket, isolate, and police those dangerous and devastated areas. However, these communities have not only been policed, right? They've been over-policed, too often using prisons and policing to replace investment and employment. It is important to note that while neoliberalism has been committed to a kind of anti-statism rhetoric, right, the shrinking of the state and state agencies, many forget that there are segments of the state that have actually grown under neoliberalism. Segments such as policing and prison industrial complex, producing what sociologist and black feminist Beth Ritchie calls our prison nation. Now, ironically, under neoliberalism, a disproportionate amount of state investment associated with these neighborhoods was not directed at residents or their living space, but instead in policing apparatus to manage the disposable black bodies and communities created through neoliberalism. The result has been the hiring of more cops, the outfitting of local police departments with military leftovers, the increasing criminalization of behaviors and encounters, the militarizing of inner city schools, filling them with metal detectors, security guards, and city cops, and the proliferation of school-to-prison pipelines, which push kids out of school and into the hands of the carceral state. The conditions of the small suburb of Ferguson, Missouri, in many ways are, I think, indicative of the neoliberal city today. For example, in 1980, 85% of residents in Ferguson were white. By 2008, 67% of residents were black. Black unemployment is nearly double that of white unemployment in Ferguson. One in four black residents, or 25%, live in poverty, compared to 11% of whites. Moreover, we know that in Ferguson, 86% of all police stops were black motorists, and of those arrested at such stops, 93% were black. Overall, 85% of all those arrested in Ferguson were black, and all of this was done under the auspices of a police force where only 3 out of 50, or 6% of officers, are black. Now, even beyond the police, the formal governing apparatus of Ferguson is white-dominated, with 5 of Ferguson's 6 city council members, the mayor, and 6 of 7 local school board members, all white in a majority black city. This was the neoliberal context that surrounded Mike Brown and Darren Wilson on that fateful day in Ferguson, Missouri. This was the context that produced a fearful white man with a gun and a badge. This was the context that produced demons and Hulk Hogan for Darren Wilson, while possibly for Mike Brown, this was the context in which he decided to push back on the kind of totality of white superiority that surrounded him every day. And this was the context that led to the killing
and the Unmaking of Michael Brown. Okay, let's go to section two. On August 12th, 2014, just 3 days after, 3 or 4 days after the murder of Michael Brown in Ferguson, Missouri, a group of LGBT, lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender organizations, signed a letter in support of the family of Michael Brown. The letter, which is relatively short, right, reads, and I'll read it to you, says, when communities experience fear, harassment, and brutality, simply because of who they are or how they look, we are failing as a nation. In light of the recent events in Missouri, it is clearer than ever that there is something profoundly wrong in our country. The lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender community cannot be silent at this moment. Because LGBT people come from all races, creeds, faiths, and backgrounds. And because all movements of equality are deeply connected. We are all part of the fabric of this nation, and the promise of liberty and justice for all is yet to be fulfilled. The LGBT community stands with the family of Michael Brown, who was gunned down in Ferguson, Missouri. We stand with the mothers and fathers of young black men and women who fear for the safety of their children each time they leave their home. We call on the national and local media to be responsible and steadfast in their coverage of this story and others like it. Racialized killings that have marred this nation since the beginning of its history. We call on policymakers on all levels of American government not to shrink from action, and we are deeply grateful to Attorney General Eric Holder and the Department of Justice for their immediate commitment to a thorough investigation. At this moment, we are inspired by the words of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. In the end, he says, we will remember not the words of our enemies, but the silence of our friends. End quote and end of the letter. Now, all in all, I would argue this is, in some ways, a powerful letter. By my count, last time I checked, 70 organizations had signed on to this letter. The organizations that decided to lend their voice range from the ACLU, to HRC, to the National Black Justice Coalition, to the Black Youth Project 100, which is an activist group that comes out of the Black Youth Project that I started. And we can say more about why they signed on to this letter. And while one might take issue with parts of the letter, that actually is not my concern this afternoon. Overall, I found the letter compelling and understand the gesture of solidarity, right? Gesture. These groups are trying to signal. Many of these organizations and the constituencies they represent are trying to avoid, right, the outrage emanating from LGBT communities of color when nothing is said about critical events in the lives of people of color. However, despite good intentions, I have to ask myself, can the same organizations that have been at the forefront of their own neoliberal policy goals truly stand with the family of Michael Brown and the young black men and women who've been killed by the police or vigilantes? Or is this an example of what we might call performative solidarity? Now, the idea that mainstream LGBT organizations have been pursuing a neoliberal agenda is kind of a well-rehearsed argument made much more extensively than I will today by the likes of Urushi Bad or Lisa Dugan, for example, to name two people who've written on this. Marriage, for example, and the increased dependence on incarceration, promoted, for example, through hate crime legislation, are but two examples of the stated policy agenda of kind of national LGBT organizations that leverage a neoliberal rights-based approach to politics that often serves to anchor poor black people to the bottom of something we might call a racial order. So let me just say a few words about each of these policies. Marriage. Is there marriage in Ohio?
No.
Not yet.
Not yet. They're working on it?
Yeah.
Don't work on it. Okay, so... So the quest for marriage equality has been discussed a lot, right? In light of recent Supreme Court rulings and the expected Supreme Court ruling, right, thought to open the way for same-sex marriage nationally. And while the advance in same-sex marriage, both in terms of public opinion and the courts, have been celebrated by many, the naysayers of marriage equality on the left have seen, actually, I think their voices muted. Specifically, there are those in gay and lesbian communities, and I count myself among them, who believe that same-sex marriage only actually helps to legitimize a process intent on producing a hierarchy of citizenship and rights bolstered by the institution of marriage. This is a hierarchy that is, I would argue, racially coded and is reflective of what scholars such as Omi and Monat label the racial order. Now, numerous scholars have written about the kind of racialized nature of state policies regulating what are thought to be deviant or non-normative families. Marriage, of course, falls into the category of a racialized state project that is involved in the differential distribution of rights that disproportionately disadvantage people who are not married, often people of color. Most explicitly, feminist scholars such as Wendy Mink and Anna Marie Smith have detailed the numerous laws that have been instituted to regulate the sex and intimate relations of women, disproportionately poor women and women of color, who have children, are not married, and need state assistance. Like heterosexual marriage, same-sex marriage replicates an unequal distribution of rights, with the middle class, who are more likely to marry, benefiting in and outside of gay communities, while poor and working class people of color, gay and straight, who are less likely to marry, are subjected to targeted regulation of their sexual, family, and intimate formations. Moreover, same-sex marriage, far from ending marriage as we know it, preserves a narrow system for the distribution of benefits that is tied to kind of heteronormative and homonormative understandings of the family. It allows the state to continue to shift its responsibility to providing for the well-being of its citizens to some private form that we label the family. As marriage and two-parent households are normalized and become the dominant discursive framework through which LGBT communities enter the national consciousness as full citizens, it puts the LGBT community, often conceptualized as white, at odds demographically with trends generally and in particular in black communities. For example, the truth about the structure of the black intimate sphere, a truth that many people don't want us to talk about, at least in the US, is that nearly 80% of children born to black women under 30 and 70% of all black children born were born to women who are not married. Data also indicates that in 2013, the majority of black children did not live in two-parent homes. So we have a dilemma. Do we kind of pretend that, in fact, the fantasy of the two-parent family is, in fact, the normative structure of black intimacy, or do we embrace black intimacy in its current form? Now, of course, 50% of white children are also born to mothers who are born to mothers under 30, are born to women, white women, who are also single mothers, right? Now, these details of the black intimate sphere, of course, make black people vulnerable to state power. State power that would regulate them not by legal disenfranchisement based explicitly on race, but instead that would mobilize a kind of colorblind ideology to minimize their status as full citizens by highlighting their incompatibility with normative expectations of family. Right? These are some of the same mechanisms we talked about a bit in part one, section one of the lecture. Right? A similar argument can be made about the use of criminalization and incarceration to protect queer bodies through hate crime legislation. Specifically, in response to the threat posed to LGBTQI individuals in the form of bullying or harassment and physical harm, some, and probably many, mainstream LGBT organizations have pursued a policy agenda that includes tougher hate crime legislation, the introduction of legislation mandating anti-discrimination policies on college campuses, and the recognition of cyberbullying as a form of harassment. And while no one would endorse, right, ignoring the threat posed to LGBTQI lives, because we know that our lives matter, There is, in fact, I think, something ironic, maybe dangerous, and clearly neoliberal, about turning to a system of criminalization to protect the lives of queer folks who are daily harassed and threatened by the same police apparatus in their neighborhoods, especially neighborhoods of color. This is what Audre Lorde, I think, meant when she wrote, "The master's tools will never dismantle the master's house." Thus, we have to ask, in the context of the expansion of the prison and policing industrial complex under neoliberalism, what does it mean to utilize the police as the protector of gay and lesbian rights? The now defunct group in Chicago, Gender Just, that was the name of the group they defunct, I think most clearly outlines the problematic nature of dealing with violence against queers through the prison industrial complex. They write, and I'll just quote, they say, "It is critical to remember that we face violence as youth, as people of color, as people living in poverty, as queers, as trans, and gender nonconforming young people. We can't separate our identities, and any approach to preventing violence must be holistic and incorporate our whole selves. Our greatest concern is that there is a resounding demand for increased violence as reaction to violence against queer youth in the form of hate crime penalties, which bolster the prison industrial complex, and anti-bullying measures, which open the door to zero tolerance policies and reinforce the school to prison pipeline." Thus, in contrast to the kind of marginalized status of many people of color, the trend among gay leadership seems to be to go for normality: marriage, criminalization, and the military. The cost, of course, of being on the side of normal, as scholars such as Dean Spade and Michael Warner have warned, is that you must participate in the neoliberal process of excluding and giving up the cause of radical transformation. Many of the most visible policy wins of the gay and lesbian agenda are policies and programs that are deeply rooted in and preserve the structural legitimacy and order of neoliberalism. These policies are markedly different from the type of policy interventions called for in many Black communities, interventions that not only legitimize but also demand a significant shift in state resources, right? We've seen a Black politics that is kind of committed to an active state, and we've seen a politics in LGBT communities that is committed to a state get out of our lives. The LGBT domain kind of seems committed to advancing a neoliberal agenda of inclusion that comes largely without substantial financial and political commitments on the part of the state, and again, is fundamentally different from the kind of trademark of Black politics, which focuses on an active state. Thus, if we go back to the letter, my concern with the letter signed by LGBT groups on August 12th is that it is completely disconnected and actually stands in opposition, right, to the normalizing neoliberal project that has defined LGBT politics over the last few decades. The letter represents a kind of momentary performative solidarity. This is what I mean by performative solidarity. That suggests a lack of comprehensive understanding of the systemic threat to Black lives. If Black lives matter to the LGBT organizations that signed that letter, then they must demand a rethinking of their policy priorities. It means understanding that pursuing a neoliberal agenda makes us complicit in Black death. It means pursuing an analysis and agenda that is not content to secure rights for our group, but is rooted in a politics of liberation of oppressed people, where our allies are individuals like punks, bulldaggers, and welfare queens. All right, so let's go on to section 3. How am I doing on time? Wendy, I'm not gonna ask you. You're like, yeah, that's okay. All right, so this is not the civil rights movement. I'm gonna need you in a minute, Diane, okay? So on December 8th, 2014, Gwen Ifill of PBS NewsHour interviewed three activists, young activists, taking part in helping to organize protests in response to the decision not to indict the police officers who killed both Michael Brown and Eric Garner. Ms. Ifill asked a series of questions about why these young activists were protesting, She then asked if this current moment of mobilization feels different. She said, does it feel different from the civil rights movement? And Tori Russell, I don't know if any of you know Tori, from Hands Up United, or Unite Hands Up, was clear that this is not, as he, I think he says, your grandmother's civil rights movement. Russell explained that this is the oppressed people's movement, and that there's room for all. All right. Now, before I show you the clip of Tori, let me just read what he says, and then you can hear him say it himself. He says, this is not the civil rights movement. You can tell by how I have got a hat on, my t-shirt, and how I rock my shoes. This is not the civil rights movement. This is the oppressed people's movement. So when you see us, you're going to see some gay folk, you're going to see some queer folk, you're going to see some poor black folk, you're gonna see some brown folk, you're gonna see some white folk. And we're all out here for the same reasons. We want to be free. We believe that we have the right over laws. I think the question that keeps coming up is what's legal? We need to be talking about what's right. We're not heading that way. So we need to go out in the streets and block some of that and make this system ungovernable and disruptive until we get our own self-determination and our own self-liberation. All right, let me show you Tori. Diamond, click right there. Perfect. Thank you.
These protests we're seeing, these coast to coast, rolling die-ins and roadblocks. Does this feel like a different stage?
Yeah, I mean, it's younger, it's fresher, and I think that we're more connected than most people think. This is not the civil rights movement. You can tell by how I got a hat on my t-shirt and how I rock my shoes. This is not the civil rights movement. This is the oppressed people's movement. So when you see us, you're going to see some gay folk, you're going to see some queer folk, you're going to see some poor black folk, you're going to see some brown folk, you're going to see some white people, and we all out here for the same reasons. We want to be free. We believe that we have the right over laws. I think the question that we keep getting into is what's legal. We need to be talking about what's right. And we're not heading that way, so we need to go out in the streets and block some of that, make this this system ungovernable and disruptive until we get our own self-determination and our own self-liberation.
Great. So in 1997, the journal GLQ published my article, Punks, Bulldaggers, and Welfare Queens, Radical Potential Queer Politics. In the opening pages of the article, I wrote, quote, I envision a politics where one's relation to power and not some homogenized identity is privileged in determining one's political comrades. Talking about a politics where the non-normative and marginal position of punks, bulldaggers, and welfare queens, for example, is the basis for progressive transformative coalition work. Thus, if there is any truly radical potential to be found in the idea of queerness and the practice of queer politics, it would seem to be located in its ability to create a space in opposition to dominant norms, a space where transformational political work can begin, end quote. Since the publication of that article, I have been, I tell people all the time, searching for the politics I wrote about, right? Sadly, over the years since the publication of that article, there have been, I would argue, few opportunities to believe that we've created a space where the transformational work could begin. However, as Tori Russell explains to Glenn Eiffel, the resistance to black death at the hands of the police, resistance generated by the lack of a legitimate legal process to the murder of Michael Brown, Eric Garner, Tamir Rice, right, raises the possibility of a reimagined transformational politics. Maybe we call it queer politics, maybe we do not, but it is a transformational moment centering our resistance around individuals like Mike Brown, Tamir Rice, and Marissa Alexander. I'm using the framework of queer not because I'm rooted, for example, to a vision of queer politics that is largely tied to LGBT communities, as you heard in the second section, but instead because I believe that queer can actually be a unifying framework, as I argued in the article, that highlights our shared oppositional position relative to dominant normalizing power. I understand that it's usually, I think, a much easier leap for those of us thinking and writing about death and violence, race and queer politics to marshal a different type of black body to mark that intersection. Individuals such as C.C. McDonald, an African-American trans woman who went to jail for second-degree manslaughter as a result of defending herself from a racist and transphobic attacker, are more, I think, traditional objects of queer analysis in politics. In many ways, CC fits our understanding of who can be the face of queer politics, even a radical queer politics. A more traditional queer politics might be more comfortable, I guess, incorporating the killing of Sakia Gunn into our analyses of LGBT and queer politics than someone like Michael Brown. Sakia was the young black lesbian who was killed in Newark, New Jersey after rejecting the sexual advances of her killer. For me, however, Michael Brown's death is deeply connected to the killing of Sakia Gunn and the attack on and incarceration of C.C. McDonald, not because of his sexual practice, identity, or performance, but instead because Michael Brown, C.C. McDonald, and Sakia Gunn, as well as other young people and poor folks of color, operate in the world as queer subjects, the targets of racially normalizing projects intent on pathologizing them across the dimensions of race, class, gender, and sexuality, making them into monsters, right? While normalizing their degradation and marginalization until it becomes what we expect, the norm, until it becomes something that we no longer pay attention to. The idea that queer can be harnessed to suggest the shared positioning of marginal subjects is underscored in yet another way. A letter by a number of New York-based progressive and queer people of color organizations issued on December 4th, 2014. The organizations that signed on to this letter were organizations were Fierce, Audre Lorde Project, Anti-Violence Project, Griot Circle, Streetwise, and SAFE, and the Sylvia Rivera Law Project. The authors start the letter by listing the names of those lost to police brutality, those lost to communal violence justified by the policing of our bodies, and those falsely accused, detained, and abused. Those listed range from Eleanor Bumpers, to Amadou Diallo, to Eric Garner, to Renita Hill, and Patrice Johnson of the Jersey Four. In no way is this a cohesive group, but they are all queer subjects in the most expansive and progressive sense of the idea. It is in the heart of the letter that the signatories make clear their vision of a radical queer movement against white supremacy. They write, quote, "We are queer as lesbian, gay, bisexual, two-spirit, trans, and gender non-conforming people of color, that our safety is contingent on the preservation of all black and people of color bodies. We have been righteous in fighting against anti-black racism and anti-immigrant oppression that allows for state-controlled white supremacy to exist and justify the murder of our people. The murders of Mike Brown, Tamir Rice, Akeem Gurley, and Eric Garner prove that black lives are seen as dangerous and expendable. For those of us that are queer, trans, black, and people of color, our bodies, our gender expression, and who we love puts us further away from the norms and has falsely perceived us as most threatening, less than human, and even more dangerous of all bodies," end quote. These organizations in their statement asking, again the quote, "In this moment, what are we willing to do to be free?" Okay. Across the country, I think people have been answering this seemingly simple question by putting their bodies, bodies that matter, on the line to disrupt everyday life and to remind those with power that black lives actually do matter. Now, one such group is the BYP 100, a group of young black activists between the ages of 15 and 35. I think the BYP 100 in many ways represents the best of what this moment promises. They are young organizers who embrace, as they say, a black feminist and queer analysis, independent of who their intimate and sexual partners are. For them, being queer is both an identity and a position relative to oppressive state power, a position that is routinely inhabited by young people of color. The BYP 100, however, is an organization that declares itself to be unapologetically black and insists on radical black leadership. These are young people who understand the governing process and have developed their own policy agenda, an agenda to keep us safe. However, even while they engage in policy debates, they also understand the limits of trusting the neoliberal state to secure their freedom. So, for example, while they support the use of body cameras on the police as a policy initiative, they also remind us that camera footage that you saw earlier did not stop the murder of Oscar Grant or Eric Garner. We might say that the BYP has their finger on policy, but their mind on freedom. They close their meetings chanting Assata Shakur's directive, "It is our duty to fight for our freedom. It is our duty to win. We must love each other and support each other. We have nothing to lose but our change." In the words of Assata Shakur, we hear the calling for a radical love or empathy. This is the love I'm reflecting about in the title of the talk. And I've been struck how often when talking with young Black activists, they raise their love of Black people as the reason that they take to the streets. There's a kind of queer nationalism that frames their work with a deep love for Black people that motivates their actions. The BYP 100 is but one example of an organization that is part of this new liberation movement developing across the country. This is a movement made up of Tory Russell, as Tory Russell described, some gay folks, some queer folks, some poor Black people, some brown people, right, some white folks, but all of them united in their position as oppressed people, AKA politically queer, and all fighting for freedom. And organizations like BYP 100, Fierce, ALP, Hands Up United, Dream Defenders, and We Charge Genocide, activists are building a politic, both in analysis and action that makes visible the transformative potential of queering Black liberation and showing the world that Black lives matter. I have watched in awe at the increasing number of people taking to the streets across the world, engaging in an intersectional and queer politics of resistance. Some of them, you know, some of them protesting are students who have taken what they learned in classes in ethnic studies, women and gender studies, African American studies, comparative race studies, and actually transformed all of our abstract theories, books and projects into campaigns that actually have meaning and impact. Others are being pulled into the street out of their own lived experience, where they know that their life and happiness is tenuous at best under the system of neoliberalism that rules the land. Still others whose identities do not mark them as disposable are moving and engaged in radical resistance because it is the right thing to do. All of these young people are insistent on being free and having their humanity recognized. As I noted earlier, I believe young activists are not only taking to the streets to protest, but in doing so, they are building the space to reimagine what freedom looks like and who is included and leading our movements for freedom. They are building on the tradition of those who challenged the police at the Stonewall riots and the Black Panther Party, who insisted on the ability of Black communities to engage in self-defense and self-determination, as well as AIDS activists who challenged the government when it denied their right to live, and Black feminists who demanded recognition and justice for Black women and girls, as well as trans activists who are changing laws, language, and how we understand ourselves even as their very lives are being threatened. These young activists, I contend, are pursuing a radical empathy and love. And we know that our freedom cannot be won without collaborative work and coalition building, but I want to suggest that our freedom cannot be sustained without a radical empathy and love that deeply connects with all of us as beings, not in an instrumental way, but in a way that highlights the fragility of the human project. Now, let me just say two quick things and then I'm finished. I want to be clear that this is not a plea to move toward a kind of post-racial utopia where the only important aspect of our existence is our human connection. I'm not saying that. Instead, what I'm trying to suggest is that at the heart of our struggles against neoliberalism, right, and structural oppression, we must remember that most people want not only structural liberation, but also personal joy. This is our attention, I think, that's why we as feminists and people who study kind of gender and sexuality have to be attentive to the intimate sphere, right? Where it is both structure and personal things like joy, happiness, connection, love, ecstasy. They want the capacity to live dignified, fulfilled, and empowered lives. Folks want to feel like they belong in their families, those they were born into maybe, and maybe more importantly, those they create. They want to belong in their communities, in their countries, in the world. These young activists are building a space to begin the work of reimagining their struggle and freedom today. And I understand that for some, the act of reimagining may seem like a luxury. But I want to suggest instead that our imagination of lives beyond struggle is in fact a necessity. It's a necessity because our vision of freedom must drive the strategy of our struggle. And because our vision of freedom should rejuvenate our commitment to the struggle and, more importantly, to each other. Thank you very much.
We have time for questions.
Questions? Answers?
I'll break the ice. Okay. Yes. So we got a lot of, you know, of good stuff going in Columbus and in Ohio around Black Lives Matter. The Ohio Student Association is a really active group here.
They are. They're amazing.
And there's all kinds of things happening. But some of it, especially with the marches, is focused on sort of marching down to the police headquarters and with a set of very clear demands. And so, well, I have several questions about that, but I'm just going to wonder what you think about focusing on the state, given the art of your talk.
Right.
Could you summarize the question?
Yes, I will.
Thank you.
She made the statement that there's lots of great activism happening right now. But that a lot of it right now are focused on kind of marching to a police headquarters, and it's very focused on the state, and what do I think about the focus on the state? I think at some level it's inevitable, right, that the state becomes a kind of most visible target, right? And those of us who study social movements, you know that in fact there are ways in which kind of Doug McAdams would talk about kind of the political process model, and you need to believe that in fact you can get wins, and you need to have a kind of clear, identifiable target. The state makes sense. Oftentimes, the kind of the mobilization is around the killing of someone. If we understand the police to be agents of the state, so boom, yes, there's the state. So that I think makes sense. I think the concern that has arisen at this point is how do you sustain these movements beyond the kind of action up against the state. I have two responses, I guess, to that. One is, so people will say, are you worried about these movements dying? And I often said that there is a kind of arrogance in the state that is amazing to me, right? Like, you would think at some point there would be like long periods where they didn't kill black people, but no, you know, they continue to kill black people. I don't mean that as funny, but it is kind of amazing to me, right? And so there is a way in which if that becomes the spark of mobilization, am I worried that it's going to completely go away? I don't. I worry less about kind of the focused nature of the mobilization, because if we remember Occupy, right, the complaint was the unfocused nature, like what, where are the demands?
Right.
So I have seen these young people really kind of trying to straddle the line between a kind of more imaginative sense of what a movement looks like versus a policy agenda. And I think in a way that I would say in the past took most activists much longer to understand that they needed a clear set of demands and a policy agenda, that these young people are generating that much quicker, right? There is a real kind of uptake in understanding that. The other thing I'm pretty interested in is the way in which the infrastructure of organizations is really changing and building out, right? So if you think about kind of Black Lives Matter, which is started by three black queer women, and now there's an organization attached to it. If you think about the Dream Defenders that was started in response to Trayvon Martin, and now there's a pretty, you know, Phil Agnew's ED is a pretty significant organization. Think about the BYP 100. So the other thing that has developed is not just that kind of mobilization, but a new infrastructure of, and I don't dare say civil rights organizations, but liberation organizations that are very much in their infancy, but I think will help to sustain this process over time. Now, what the end goal looks like, it's not clear. The last thing I'll just say is, I think there's also this kind of interesting moment of both visibility and invisibility. What I mean by that is, I don't know if you've heard some of the comments from Al Sharpton about this generation, his silliness. and I'm being generous when I say his silliness. But I do think that there's a way in which the organizing looks different, and it becomes much less visible or legible to the kind of old civil rights guard. And the concern, I think, for many of the young activists is that guard still controls many of the resources, right? And so if you're doing what I consider to be doing great work, a lot of it both online and offline, you know, holding to a kind of feminist queer analysis. So if you take, again, an organization like the BYP100, who will say, we refuse to have the one charismatic leader out front. And, you know, I'll have reporters call me and say, why don't they have who's their leader? And it's like, well, they have multiple leaders. They have a different model of organizing. So there is a kind of mismatch between how they're moving and transforming in terms of their organizing and what we're used to seeing. And I think sometimes we underestimate what's actually going on because it doesn't look like what we saw in the 70s or even the 80s and for sure in the 60s. Yes.
Thank you so much. This was so, I know I'm going to continue to be thinking about this. This is powerful to me partly because I've done some thinking about the similarities between lynching and anti-LGBT violence, that everything you're saying really brings home for me in powerful ways. Mm. Because one of the things that I think those things have in common is that it's a backlash against success, right? So very often you're lynched because you're successful, not because you're a criminal. And I feel like that's part of what's going on with anti-LGBT violence. So this is linked to the question they have, because one of the successes that I feel is happening as a backlash to LGBT activism is, okay, you had policy victories like Don't Ask, Don't Tell. You have the Supreme Court coming out in support of marriage equality, so on and so forth. These victories very much are feeding into the neoliberal, you know, everything you said about that really resonates with me as only supporting the state and a certain kind of capitulation. Nevertheless, it does represent a kind of success that people want to put in check. And so it feels to me like going against those successes is part of what fuels anti-LGBT violence. Mm. So this idea of the police and marching to the police and is that a dead end, for me, feels connected to that. Mm. But what you said about making the state financially committed really drives it home. And actually, this quotation here, commitment without cash is counterfeit.
I saw that when I walked up.
So it feels to me, I just want to make sure I understand what you're putting on the table. So when you say...
Me too.
So it feels to me like part of what you're saying is that if the goal is to make the state financially committed to redistribute resources, then that's the thing that undoes the neoliberal thing that might be represented by what I'm calling a victory with Don't Ask, Don't Tell. Is that what you're saying? That when they make the state actually put up some money and invest in people's lives, invest in the safety net, invest in more than one kind of person, like a married person getting funds, then is that what you mean about how this addressing the state that Shannon is talking about could be transformative? So in other words, don't just go to the police and demand X, but demand that the state redistribute wealth and resources.
I think that's, first of all, a great question, and I would love to read the work that you're doing. But I think you're right. I'm hoping at a kind of more micro level, that's what I'm saying. I'm saying that if we understand kind of this thing we're calling success, or the integration of LGBT individuals into some kind of normative understanding of what an American society looks like, right? So we're changing American society in the world. Then we have to understand kind of at what price that entry, is paid. And, you know, activists and scholars long before me have talked about kind of the loss of liberation in LGBT communities. And so what does, you know, what would it look like to imagine liberation and freedom, right? And how do we understand kind of our deep connections outside of certain types of identities around liberation and freedom, right? And I think for, if you look at kind of the history of Black mobilization, that vision of liberation and freedom has often included what I've talked about, others have, as an activist state, right? The distribution of resources, the ability for people to kind of have the support they needed independent of family structure, right? I mean, it would mean rethinking how we understand something called family, right? There's a whole kind of thing I've been trying to write and get through, which is to talk about kind of what does it mean when we really kind of absorb and take in the nature of Black intimacy as a structure today, right? Mm-hmm. It means a different type of policy agenda for sure. But, you know, we want to understand who's policing that and the ways in which it gets policed through kind of, in part, a neoliberal president like President Obama. I mean, part of the reason, if you talk, in many of the surveys we've done, you know, we talk to Black people about their love for President Obama has everything to do with his family structure, mm-hmm. right? It is the kind of antidote to the pathologizing of Black deviance, yeah. right? And so what does, you know, how do we create those spaces where we can now kind of reimagine all of those fundamental concepts in many ways that match up with the reality that we're living already. And I think part of what I'm trying to say is I think in this kind of new youth-led movement, you have young people who are embracing this opportunity to reimagine. That I think what they're doing is not just saying, here are our demands, but it's saying, here are our demands, but also here's our vision of a different type of society, possibly, right? And surely, here are our demands, and here's our understanding of a different type of way in which we will structure our mobilization. I was talking with, I don't know if you know, Donna Merck, who's a historian. She was talking, we were talking about this idea of kind of queer nationalism, like the two things you would just never put together, maybe. But you see these, and I know I'm rambling all the way from your, away from your question, I'm sorry, but you see these young people putting Black feminism in conversation with the Panthers often. Now, part of that, they will tell you, is because those are the kind of two moments of political history that they know. And they don't have any idea about what happened in the 80s or the 90s, really. But there's a kind of fascination with the Panthers because, again, the Panthers stand in opposition to the Civil Rights Movement, and they're clearly don't want to be the Civil Rights Movement. And many of them are young enough, and I keep saying this, that many of them have come through classes in college, those who come to college or not, where they now kind of live a kind of feminist understanding of what liberation and organizing could look like. And so that, this is a kind of, to me, a very special moment that I hope we're not losing. And it's through these new formations that I think this re-envisioning of what society, at least organizing, might look like, that's where it's happening. Yeah. Yes?
So I really, this is great to hear you, your work. Goes my brain apart and makes me keep writing. It's great to hear your framework, but I have two questions.
Yes.
I really heard over and over, I mean, you reiterated earlier also, this sort of mourning for the loss of the liberationists and the liberation movement.
Mm-hmm.
As there is this kind of present generation's rethinking, and so it's very helpful for me to hear you, someone who's a senior scholar, to reframe this moment.
You mean old, right? That was very senior.
I was engaging for
that's right. I appreciate that.
But my question is on two fronts. I mean, this sort of, I mean, as someone who's been a long-time activist and, you know, has had to put out similar kinds of letters in response to other letters, you know, so I really appreciate you examining this letter, and especially something like National Black Justice Coalition, who's big, you know, on gay marriage.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So taking on from internally that an organization is a great project. But this sort of, you know, mourning and like melancholia and rethinking for liberation,
mm-hmm.
I don't buy this as much.
Right.
So I didn't buy your rhetoric as much,
right?
Because I'm skeptic.
Yes.
You know, because my question is, what are the objective conditions of freedom that
mm-hmm.
this demand, this uprising moment will go towards?
Mm-hmm.
Because the parallel in my work is the dream activists.
Yes.
The parallel in immigration work is Dolores Huerta, you know, or, you know, that kind of sort of radical movement, those radical upsurges are built around labor, now completely around accommodation of certain bodies by the state.
Yes.
You know, and it gives relief, I totally get that.
Right.
So, I mean, how does this radical work not become radical performative also?
I hear you totally. So let me go back to why I'm sorry.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm so sorry. I think this question of liberation has everything to do, actually, with age for me. In the sense that, so my first book was Boundaries of Blackness, and it really documents this early moment in the AIDS crisis, right, where the infrastructure of where the gay movement moves to, I would argue, an infrastructure of service, and we can argue survival. But so much of the discussion of this kind of term had everything to do with the kind of loss of the liberation movement that people talked about. What might have been possible after Stonewall, right? What does the kind of, you know, how gay communities, and in particular, you might say gay ghettos like the Village, right? How they were organizing, how sex was reconceptualized, how all of that was kind of lost at this moment where in fact the threat was supposedly about sexuality, right? So there is a way in which I think I am attached to that kind of division between a moment of liberation and then a kind of crushing reality that nips that in the bud to some degree. Why is this moment not a kind of radical performative moment? I can't say for sure that it isn't. I can say that I think, well, I mean, this is the question, maybe you might have a better answer than I, so I'm gonna
just ask you to give me hope.
No. The question is, how do we ever know, right? So, it seems to me that there's a clearer sense of the divide between kind of a more liberatory framework versus, I don't want to call it accommodationist framework that's thought about kind of incorporation into the state. And many people would say that's what we've seen with the dream activists. And let me say, I love a dream activist. I think that's important, but the way in which it's now been kind of packaged about who is good enough or normative enough to receive kind of acceptance into the state. So to me, that's an easier divide to kind of point to. The question between a kind of an embrace of a kind of radicalness that really is sustained and real and builds something versus a kind of radical performative stance, I think that's one of those that you have to kind of look at over time. I would point to, you know, is there an infrastructure that reflects the kind of radical nature of the pursuit? And what I mean by that is when I look at some of the organizations that are being created now and the ways in which they structured something like leadership, who can talk, the kind of the individuals that they attach their work to, so it's not just the Panthers, but it's Asada in particular, right? There's something about, you know, liberation fighter, black woman, increasingly we might call Asada a feminist, right? So I think there are just certain types of markers. I think the movement in their writing also between I'm thinking of like the Dream Defenders and the BYP movement, between a kind of policy agenda that's also as skeptical as we are, right? So in their policy agenda that they've written up and, you know, printed, they talk about, these are the things that we need to keep us safe, but let's be clear, they won't really keep us safe, right? So there is a kind of skepticism even in their own analysis to me that suggests a deeper commitment to kind of radical liberationist vision that's not just kind of performing radical performances. Those are some of the markers, I think, but hard to tell. I'd love to hear what you think about this. Yes?
So you talked a lot about radical love, and I was just wondering what you found to be normatively significant about of radical empathy, especially because empathy conveys this sort of imaginatively imagining the perspective of others, and maybe there might be limits to what some people can imagine, and to what challenges come from radical empathy and why that's important.
I think that's it. So I felt like I didn't talk enough about it. And it's, no, in the sense that I'm trying to kind of think through it, because it does feel a little Pollyannish, right? Love, you know, that's not where I usually go. But it started really with kind of just listening how often people said, and in the meetings I would say, why are you doing this work? Because I love black people, and I think, do I? I do love black people. And so how do you figure love into your political analysis, right? I mean, others, you know, Bell has talked about it and things like that. The empathy part is harder for me right now, in part because of what you just said, kind of the imagining of others' struggle, the connection without control. And I think actually it's playing out, we'll see how it plays out, in the Black Lives Matter framework. So I don't know if you follow what they're doing, but there have been kind of Muslim Lives Matter, and the three women who started this wrote a pretty impressive and I thought interesting blog, Patrice, I've been talking to Patrice about why they reject the idea of other groups taking on Black Lives Matter, right? About the centrality of black struggle. There's a guy, John Marquez, who's a, hopefully soon, associate professor at Northwestern, who talks about kind of black foundational struggle, that you know, you can have all sorts of struggle, but you have to understand the kind of ways in which blackness and the struggle around anti-blackness has often, not completely and totalizing, framed the racial order, but is a significant part of that. And so without some acknowledgement of that, you can't just adopt the name, right? Black Lives Matter now becomes Muslim Lives Matter, becomes Gay Lives Matter, right? There's a way in which you then participate in making invisible the specificity and the significance of those struggles. So I'm trying to figure out through this kind of idea of radical empathy, how the kind of radical component means a different way in which we practice or perform, we might say, empathy, right? That there is a kind of way in which it has to be, again, deeply connected, but without, in fact, demeaning or minimizing the privileging of certain types of struggles and structural relationships. So it might mean that, you know, that we recognize something like Black Lives Matter, but we also want to stand in solidarity with folks who are in other struggles, and what we do is we find new frameworks that can attach to Black Lives Matter without saying Black Lives Matter, right? Without taking that, or, you know, All Lives Matter, which then completely minimizes the kind of necessary struggles of that. You know, the other thing for me about just empathy, radical empathy, I actually started writing about it, I never finished, around the immigration rights protests, where there were just no black people. I mean, well, I should say, no African Americans. There were black Latinos, for example. And I kept thinking, why? Like, where is everybody at here? And it was this question of, how do we think about something more than just talking about collaboration, right? How do you think about kind of a deeper, sustained connection to struggle? And this goes back to this idea of also kind of, this idea of kind of politically queer, right? That can we put Mike Brown, Zakiya Gunn, CeCe McDonald, Darian Albert, who's a young black man who was killed in Chicago by other young black men, you know, is there something about their positioning relative, often, again, we go back to the state, that connects them? And that was also the impetus for Punks, Bulldaggers, and Welfare Queens, right? Like, is there something about your relationship as an oppressed person to the state that should connect us? And it has to be, I think the empathy part comes, it has to become more than just we're all in opposition to the state. It has to be something also of deep connection among us. And that's the empathetic part. Yeah. It needs a lot more work. So, yeah. Yes.
Thank you so much for this. A thing that I kept hearing throughout a lot of this, I kept hearing a lot of issues of legibility with these kind of politics, both the legibility of these young black activists to more established and more resourced older generations, but also the legibility of a radical politics while still engaging in policy work. How does your radical politics stay legible while, if instead of just divesting from policy entirely, which for some of us is tempting, or what we do, but for some people is not possible. Right. And so that, I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about the struggles of legibility, especially in this struggle to find, to build more than coalitions, these new politics around shared relationships to systems of power, which thank you for writing that, because it changed how I thought.
Oh, great, thank you.
Sorry.
You said it all. You know, towards the end of the question and answer, you're like, I don't have anything else to say. Well, yeah, I will say that we've been thinking a lot about, and there's a group of us trying to write on these issues and things like that, about the kind of, in particular, the question of legibility around organizing today, the structure of organizing. And, you know, there's a, just a kind of talking past each other when you talk to the kind of old civil rights guard and these young activists. There was a big conference through UIC, through the Social Justice Initiative, called Freedom Dreams, that was in May. And you had lots of folks from, for example, SNCC, some people from Panthers, and lots of the young activists before, for example, Mike Brown. And even then, you heard the kind of, I don't get what they do, you know, is it really organized? I mean, it's just online. You know, that's just the basic part of legibility stuff. But, you know, there is a way in which the bigger question is, the different question for me is, like, why should young activists have to be beholden to making themselves legible because kind of older activists control access to resources, right? And how do we kind of engage in discussion about the kind of, not just the transfer of mobilizing, which often happens among the young, but the transfer of power in the kind of social justice arena that, you know, where the civil rights movement is still, you know, the thing. And, you know, you heard it, I think, in Tory's statement, you know, how many times is he gonna say, this is not the civil rights movement, right? And if you talk to young activists, at least that I've talked to, they're very clear that what they're doing is something different. It's a legibility to that guard. It's a legibility to, I think, another really important component is the media. So if you're thinking about kind of how you sustain movements, it's not only that you bring people into your movements, but that those that we call bystanders, people who are not going to join your movements but might see you on television or online, or that they understand what you're doing. And usually that information is transmitted through the media, some form of media. I've been struck at how the media seems not to understand the structure of what's happening now. I mean, you know, we just left Black History Month, so goodbye to that. But, you know, that's the month you get, I'm sure Wendy does too, a call every day from some reporter every day who wants to ask you a silly question. And it usually has something to do with, you know, what are Black people going to do because there's still no king? And it's like, well, yes, there is no Martin Luther King, but actually there's a different way of thinking about organizing. And the fact that, you know, the other part of the legibility thing for me is that I think what also is illegible is really the structure of organizing in the civil rights movement, right? The invisibility of the work, for example, of women, right? So actually, in many ways, it's different, but it's not radically different, because in fact, the way in which women worked back then is often how women work now, but now it's also thought to be the leadership of these organizations, right? So to me, there's a kind of legibility that goes backwards and a legibility that goes forward. Just real quickly on the kind of, I think, the tension between policy and what might be called more radical politics. I think a lot of these groups are kind of struggling with that. And part of this has to do with this legibility also, which is how do you sustain yourself financially? And foundations and unions all have money, and they're willing to fund these groups to do things like GOTP work, right? Get out the vote work, or you know, kind of more limited policy work. They're not interested in something called liberation movement, right? And so I think they're also trying to figure out not just how to be legible, but how to recreate systems that will allow them to sustain themselves financially. So for example, I know BYP 100 just because they're there with me. You know, they are building what's considered to be a membership, right? So they have chapters in different cities and they ask members, young people, to pay in part so that they can have some basic level of funding where they're not always kind of shopping their wares to do work like, you know, to basically do contract work so that they can have a stipend. So I think there are all these ways in which trying to be legible, trying to sustain yourself are kind of at play here.
Yeah.
That's great.
Thank you.
You tell me, is this the last question?
Yeah, let's take this is the last question.
Ta-da.
Thank you. To somewhat piggyback on what you just mentioned, I've been really toying with this question of what's the business plan of social justice?
Yeah.
Right. With my doing work in community, it seems like there are three groups of people who get like kind of ranting around over teachers, or some form of community educators, activists, and artists, right? Because their bottom line is not monetary, it's whatever they think change is supposed to be. And so you say, oh, come do this work, or come teach this, or come in, and they're willing, but at the end of the day, they still have to keep the lights on. So, this also is after listening to kind of the business plan of the Panthers, which was an interesting one. Not only did they kind of sell newspapers and stuff, but they also did kind of like a Robin Hood, like rob banks, and kids kind of thing. But I'm wondering, how do you see sustainability happening in a structure where people are illegible? Right, so when I'm working with community groups who are doing really great work, but it's like, oh, there's this grant out here, and they're just kind of like, either they don't necessarily have the time to write it, or they don't necessarily have the language to use the buzzwords to make sure that this foundation funds their work, or need that the right nonprofit to work through, because they can show that they can sustain this type of money, you know?
Yes.
So like, what do you see this other, something completely else happening, or how would you see that plan working to people to be
sustained? No, it's a great question. I don't know what the other is. I mean, this question of capacity in particular for small community-based organizations who often are doing very good localized work, sometimes contained work, where they don't have the capacity or the time to kind of write the grant. They don't often know about the grant, right? They don't sometimes have the time or capacity to write the grant, and too often they don't have the capacity to manage the grant. So if you get the money and then you aren't able to kind of meet your deliverables and write the kind of nice report that can cover up the deliverables that you didn't meet, you know, it becomes very difficult. I think everyone suffers with this question of how do you build a movement that isn't dependent on, for example, philanthropy, in the sense of kind of traditional organizations, whether it's the Ford Foundation or the Woods Fund in Chicago, where, you know, they change their priorities and you're no longer receiving money, or they give you seed money, but there's no way for you to sustain the projects that you started. I mean, I think people have tried to do more innovative work. I remember, again, in the 90s, around HIV/AIDS, where Housing Works started, you know, and I think who else has it? In Chicago, kind of like a vintage shop, you know, where people would donate things from their home and then they'd resell it. So that became a way in which to generate resource. We joked at the Black Youth Project about opening up like a coffee shop, right? I mean, that there is a way in which now the social justice model for sustaining itself is how do you develop a business, right, where you can generate revenue, but not for profit, so to speak, but in fact to generate, you know, to support and sustain the movement. I think people consistently struggle with this, and we don't know. I mean, one of the reasons the BYP 100 is still at the University of Chicago is because there are in-kind things that we can get. I can get them an office and a phone and computers and people who will help with the grants and things like that. And they will probably have to move away because the type of work they want to do is not always what the university wants to be known as doing. So, but yeah, it's a great question.
Thank you all. I have some people to thank even wider. Yes. Thank you. Magnitude could not be put together just by a singular entity or a single department. So I want to thank our partners, the Office of Diversity and Inclusion, the Multicultural Center, Departments of African and African American Studies, Political Science, English, Comp Studies, the Sexuality Studies Program, the College of Education and Human Ecology, and DISCO. So that is by you bring collaboration. Oh. Thank you all for coming. Enjoy your day, and I told you it would be worth a walk in the rain.